water. So you're welcome to sit down and listen to however long you want to listen to. I just sang a women's traditional song, and the women wear regalia like in the far panel over there. She has the one on this side where the shawl is over. So they dance really slow, and their feet are to the earth. And then they have the otters right here, and they're massaging the earth, and their feet are massaging the earth. And they're giving prayers to the earth because women are like Mother Earth. They are life givers. We can carry the babies in our bellies, and they are born in water. So women are really are to take care of the water, which is Nibi, which is the other part that we're going to be talking about. And that we follow Grandmother Yuma, and she helps us. She helps us do our job. So the women take care of the water, and the men take care of the fire. So, and then the state of what our people are in is, in 2005, we start, our way is oral stories. So we start doing walks from Nova Scotia to BC. I'll show you later on this screen, but Aboriginal people always had and understood a way of life, like you always hear the circle of life, you know, like Lion King is famous for what they say down there. And all of those things are true. Aboriginal people are very connected to the land, and we knew what we knew. How else could we have survived for thousands and thousands of years? And upon contact, things start happening. Oppression, colonies, colonization, policies, all those types of things. So these are just some historical facts. The British North American Act, 1947, started making policies, and it really impacted Aboriginal women. We couldn't own land. We were seen as being too loud. The worldview that came in thought that women should be quiet, no voice, no nothing. So, and the men were to be given more power the way they see things. So that impacted the land, it impacted women to oppress. And then the other thing is, displacement happened where our First Nations people were moved around to different places, and reserves were created. So sometimes people were uplifted from where they were and put somewhere else. And then the women are supposed to take care of the children, the women are supposed to take care of the land, the herbs, the gardens, the medicines, the ceremonies, the language. The men are to be protecting. So those, all, if you think of those things, when those policies came in, the residential schools, the 60 scoops, that was all disrupted because the children were in the middle, the grandmothers and the grandfathers were in the middle, the women were in the middle, and the men were outside. Now it's opposite. The men are in the middle, and who's outside is the children. Because those, as women, we are life givers, and life cannot go on without children. So they are the most exposed. And so we're trying to flip that now. And you wouldn't see us here 5 years ago, 10 years ago at the CNE with this display of showing what's happening to our people. So the truth is coming out. The truth and reconciliation start coming out. And now the missing murdered Aboriginal women, the last 3 years they've done an inquiry that we asked for. And we're saying it's genocide. And some people don't want to accept that. But the hard facts of 2,380 stories talk about what happened within the police or the non-search of the women. Sometimes you'll hear people say, why don't your people just get over it? We can't, because we're still in it. We're still in it, and we're trying to get out of it. And the only way that we know how to get out of it is start picking our bundles back up that was taken, which is our ceremonies, our songs, our language, and things like that, to help us. And develop relationships with other races of people of the truth. And when people say, what can you do? Well, start sharing what we share, the truth about things, and that's what's happening. This face is so awkward, I'm so sorry. So this was the guy that was responsible for our assimilation that wanted our people to become like their people. So he didn't didn't like that we had long hair. He didn't like that we had regalia. He didn't like, they thought of us as savages. So they thought they were coming in to save us, you know, the saving syndrome. We know the answer for your people. And nothing to this day works that they've developed that helps our people. It's getting worse. We're the highest people incarcerated, the highest people with cancer, the highest people with diabetes. Every time you turn around, somebody has cancer. I work with a doctor, I work with herbalists, and the rates are getting higher. We've developed our own health system. We're the first in Canada to do that. It's three of us women that have developed that to help our people. And when people come in, we are saying, well, what did the doctor say? What did the psychiatrist say? What the bone specialist say? We say, forget all of that. Just tell us your story. What's happening? What's happening to your body? What's happening to your mind? What's happening to your spirit? What's happening to your emotion? So when they start telling us that, okay, then we can come up with a plan. We can help you with ceremony, we can help you with medicines, we can help you with counseling, we have people that do massages, and we all use our sight. So it's all from a spiritual point of view. So then we got money for a grant after 5 years because people are saying, how do you know this works? Well, it does. Okay, so then we start asking people. So we just put our report out to the people, and the highest thing that they are saying is they are listened to, they are validated, and feel respected. That's the main three things. And who doesn't want that? As oppressed people, too long our voice has been covered and we're not heard. So then they're finally being heard, and some of the pain management, all of those things have decreased, and getting their life back on track. So this is what they wanted. Their goal was for us to look like, to take our regalias. Like, do you have favorite things in your house that your mom, your grandfather, your dad, your people that in your house say, oh, that's for someone. All these special things that you have, or that you wear sometimes. Well, it's no different. This was made by my daughter. She said, don't you give that away, because I'm famous for giving things away. When I think somebody likes something here, then, you know, like, or if you need a job here, then, because that's who we are. Just like when people came on our land, we said, Kanada, which means, welcome to our village. Isn't this beautiful? You're welcome to use everything. That's what Kanada really means. And they thought we were saying, oh, this is Canada. We were saying Kanada. So that's how we're supposed to be. We should share and help. And when people came upon contact, they were sick. And we made sure that they got the medicines and got looked after. But do you see how it's transformed from to the suits? So I'll show a picture in a couple of slides how over 150,000 of our children are taken from our communities, their hair cut, their clothes taken, and put into these suits. And had to pray to a God that was outside themselves. When we feel our Creator is, we are part of Creator inside. It's not outside of ourselves, it's right here. Because in our language, we are part of the earth. Our blood is part of the earth. We are made of the wind, the earth, and the sky. This is only one residential school. There was over 80 residential schools, and they just closed in 19, the last one closed in 1980. It wasn't too long ago. I was like 20 maybe. When I was 1961, when I was born, I'm happy that my mother made sure I didn't get taken and was in one of these places. But my mother and all my aunts were taken. Were taken to these places, and at 27, I said, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? Why am I angry? And all of the elders in my home talked about this. I didn't even know about it. That's how shielded I was. And they talked about their tongue being cut. They couldn't talk to their siblings. They were abused, all of these things. And then 20 years later, Phil Fontaine, the national chief, said on TV, I've been abused when I went there. And then the floodgates opened. So that's why that presidential, that RCAP came in the Truth and Reconciliation came, and now this piece. Now there's another piece, the 60s group. They're suing the government now because our children are all over the place. They're all over. It has surpassed 150,000 that was taken for this piece. Now Cindy Blackstock is heading this, the Jordan's principal, you might have heard that, to help our our families, our women. As a mother, can you imagine your children being ripped from your arms and never see them? Some people even, there's pictures of like teepees and that beside residential schools, just to be close to their children, maybe to catch a glimpse of them playing, because they thought one day that they'll have them back so they can be with them. Who are they supposed to pass it on if there's nobody there? Who? You know, like George's principle, because that came about, the government was fighting over who was going to take care of that child for 3 years. And he ended up dying in the hospital. So the mother, she went up, she had other children she was trying to look after. She went on the streets, she became an alcoholic, and she died on the streets. And the father, I don't know what happened to him. So now, it's the responsibility of the government if a child is sick. They have to provide that health care. Then those two governments can go fight over there. But they have to look after them now. It's law now. And if that, you know, came up because someone died. This picture, Cecilia Thunderheart blew up this picture, a lot of pictures of the residential school. And the eyes are half shut. And what that means is they are in post-traumatic distress. So a lot of those children that came out had such shock being in there. And then when they came out, where do they fit? Maybe they didn't speak anymore. Maybe they were scared to speak. I didn't even know my grandmother knew the language when all these people were in my home in 1987. She started talking the language. I said, what are you saying? And she started talking about the language, the ceremonies, how she got her name. Her name was Shaking Flower, all of these things. But as soon as she left, I'd see her and I'd say, hey, I got a question. And I'd ask her something, and she would just turn her back. That hurt. That really hurt when she did that. And you know why she would do that? Why do you think she turned her back on me in public? I was her granddaughter. One of her over 100 grandchildren. She was scared. The trauma was so deep, she was scared because she didn't want what happened to her happened to me. That's why. But when she came to my home, she felt safe, she felt she could open up, and that was the first time that I knew my clan, how they got the name, about the medicines, all these things. She would open up and she'd come to my home and these other elders would be sharing, but soon as she'd leave, zip, nothing. Because the fear was so deep. Some things don't affect on women. So now, where we're at today is they started a study in 2005, and new stories by that walk I was talking about, and they discovered that there was over 500 women missing, murdered. And then after 5 years, the government said, okay, we'll take that over. This must be kind of serious. So they took it over for 5 years, and they were supposed to tell us what are they going to do about it. And then all of a sudden, 5 years later, they released another report saying, we thought it was wrong. And then a big uproar occurred, not just from our people, but other people that had compassion and caring in their hearts said, we have to do something about this. And we kept pushing for a public inquiry and have vigils and education. So it finally came out in 2016. We had this inquiry, which was finished in June, and was handed to Prime Minister, because he promised at this event a few years ago that he would do this inquiry. So we have on our book over 4,000 now, but it's more. Because when you do these walks, it's a lot of grief. And then finally, a family or somebody comes up and says, this happened to my sister. I have to call my mom. This happened to my cousin. Like, they're just in so much trauma, like, because no one's doing that before. You won't see it. You won't see it in the newspaper, nothing. So I started a Facebook page called Never Talk About Broadway in 2006 when a woman got killed in my community. I was actually doing a report at the McMaster when I was going there in the Women's Studies course, and this happened to my friend. So I took a week off, and when I went back to class, I went to present this. And I said, who in class here knows about how to kill? Because it wasn't in the newspaper. But I didn't know that. And not one person put their hand up, because they didn't know. And I'm going to clerk, I can't present, but I just go clerk. I have to finish report later with the class about this, but that's what I just, I use that energy to change what I could. So I start having visuals and blocks. I can't identify anymore families that were going through this, feeling so alone. Because that person mattered. It was a mother, it was a sister, it was a grandmother, it was somebody. And then the next person I met was a homeless. Place in her mother.
Thank you.
retire in this town at 70, what's seven times more like you to be a senior? Do many of these know much about Robert Pickton? He was a farmer in Oregon. Robert Pickton, most of those women who were discovered there were Indigenous. And I met a high school PE lady, and she, there's many that were in a lot of them were in here. But they tried to tell the other officers that they felt was happening. And she went, I met one of them, and she started a story, and she knew it was happening. Her lips were bad, she was picking us, because she knew. And his brother, looks like him, and he was spotted in downtown east side of the living room where the children were. Basically, they got us there.
Tough one. Does he look like him?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. He went. This is a few years ago, so it was, you know, it goes all across the country. It's not just in one spot that are missing or murdered women, woman is. This is an old road we're working on, it's our car. None of us have created something like this, but I'm working for this so that it's something that's still more awareness to put on a vehicle. These are fun families that I start working with. This is still a few more. Probably 10 families in my area. These are farm women that their families that they were just battered and made. So I gave a bag to put in those families and they go to their office and they to honor their daughter or their mother or their sister or their grandmother. And then these little girls in between projects started. While they're talking, these dolls are made. And then they just put them in the rows of schools or cases, and they start having discussions just like this. Why is this happening? And the main question that they have is, what can I do? So the inquiry is happening. Now the government has to step up. Vigil we had in Fort Norwood. Some more women joined us and wanted us to come there. So we did a vigil on the water because it's so significant to women as life and diversity. This is our picture of me and my girls. We printed a CD, some songs were coming to us to help lift up the families. And that's what we did. We took it to the average of people's music awards. And at that time, they were making it known nationally. And have you heard of Tufante? Tufante was found in the river. Did you know that? So that's when more things came up. And we got to go down by the river at that time. The thing was, we were pushing for the plan, we had a plan, now it's just been exactly the people that are trying to wrap together on what we're going to do. And this report is big. It's big, it has a lot of stories for in here, because we are loyal people. It's just like a plan, you're sitting in the plan, you're hearing that story. It has a bigger impact than just say this. So it's taking me a while to read it. Because you know, these stories are happening across Canada, lots of importance in place. This is the first time maybe story was told, and it's wrong. It's no different than the first time you know, but it helps when they feel connected, because everybody else in the room understands about not maybe their daughter's son at home, or maybe they're going to come home and hear that laugh or something, or they want the kids to feel that. There was
So even though they give it to us, pregnant, they have a little ceremony, they treat it like a baby, and they wrap the medicine in it and put off, and that's how they handle their report.
Can that lady go over? Yeah.
First you can hear songs. Because we're supposed to get up and sing those songs. Everybody has a song. We believe that every week the prophet, everybody has a song. So that's what we do at our Sunday mothers. That's what a sunrise ceremony is called. We gather. The speakers are probably about a sunrise ceremony Saturday. We want Sunday. That's the good thing. Everything goes good. Everybody's taken care of. Everybody gets to have a big meal at the end of the day. So you're welcome to come. It's about an hour from here, and it's just a social time to learn and share. So that's all Creator wants us to do, to remind each other to be good and responsible and respectful to each other. And when you see the average of people with us, it's about the water. Mother Earth's love. So, because once she's done for our week, we need her. She doesn't need us. Remember, she just doesn't need us. We're the last to create. We're the last to create. The sun, the moon, the flowers, the trees, the grasses. We're the last one. We created humans to enjoy everything. And we don't forget. Creator knows we're human. We make mistakes. That that's to help each other, remind each other. So I'm just going to show you something. And I see this new,
Somebody, God's healed this
guardian, but the children.
Thank you, Val.